been in on and just worked through lesson two. And just go through that and work it out, and you'll be probably pretty much up to where we are. Amen. Some points I wanted to make on page 17, seven things we see from Philippians 2, verses 19 through 21. Now, these are some very important observations from Philippians 2. Amen. 19 through 21. Those scriptures we read last week, found on page 12. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state, for all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, the objective of this lesson is something that we can look at again, to identify God's main interest. And I think that I'm not sure whether we specifically pointed that out, but we've been focusing on that a whole lot. Most of us know the primary interest or responsibility we have as believers is to promote the interests of our Heavenly Father. And that three primary interests of our Lord for the lost. Amen. That's God's primary interest. It's page 14 at the top of the page. Three primary interests of our Lord are the lost. Amen. The Holy Spirit baptism and believers growing up spiritually. Okay, so those are the things that God is primarily interested in. Okay, I want you to turn to Psalm 67. I got a little something I want to throw in. Psalm 67. Okay, this says, this God be merciful unto us and bless us and cause his face to shine upon us, Selah. They that wait, that thy way may be known upon earth, thy saving help among all nations. Okay, it says that thy way be made known upon earth. God wants his way be made known, and thy saving help among all nations. In other words, he wants the healing message and the salvation message. Amen. Spread it throughout the earth. In fact, salvation and healing are all in the same atonement. Amen. And I think the old timers really had a real revelation when they focused on years ago. It was a very strong focus on the healing ministry. And as a result of focusing very heavily on the healing ministry, it was a way, like a dinner veil to salvation. A lot of people are usually drawn when our healings and people are being set free physically. Amen. So that might be something that's one of the focuses that we had on the little book that we just made available to you. It's called The Lord's Compassion. And that book focused very heavily on God's compassion for the sick, the mercy displayed in the Old Testament and New Testament towards those that were sick. Amen. It's a lot of emphasis. And if you go back and look throughout the Old Testament, there's a lot of instances in which the Lord's mercy was directed towards people that were sick. We can go back as far as, and I think it's a good emphasis today because there's an epidemic of what? Killer diseases. I mean, it just getting almost, you know, just going all, just working havoc all through the body of Christ. And I think that this is a perfect time that we can really begin to focus on what? Healing. And by focusing on the healing message, then what happens is that people will many times be healed or be drawn to church or drawn in an environment where the Lord's compassion is being shared, and they will get healed. And the little story that we told about Dwight Moody, D.L. Moody, was that for every person that that really hear a message on compassion, that usually get 12 people saved, whereas if you were preaching on hell or the judgment and things like that, compared to one out of 12, you know, one would get saved, where 12 would get saved if you're preaching the love of God. And that would also be the healing message. So if you really want to get really established in the compassion for the sick, we have a whole line of information in this little book, The Lord's Compassion. And I really suggest that you really begin to meditate that, because I think something is going to rise up through you, and it's going to really begin to cause you to really begin to seek God and to release your faith and to get built up. You know, you got to study the scripture. You got to run these references on all of these incidents where Jesus healed. And, you know, it's really good. So I just wanted to call your attention to that, because God's primary interest is reaching the lost. And healing is a way that God really wants to, what, bring the lost in. Amen. When they see the power, when they see the anointing, when they see the compassion of the Lord and his interest and how much he wants people to be healed, that's a strong message to show people that the Lord is really concerned about them, amen, physically. And that usually opens the door for people to be saved. Amen. So we just wanted to throw that out. The little book, The Lord's Compassion, is really something that have really motivated me to really begin to seek the Lord, so that we can really begin to focus on the sick, amen, again, in terms of building their faith up. All right, so the three areas, the three primary interests of our Lord are the lost, the Holy Spirit baptism, and believers growing up spiritually. Amen. There's a scripture that we have heard in Timothy concerning God's will. And, you know, one thing we don't want to overlook is, you know, what is God interested in? You know, sometimes we don't think through that. And I think that if we are not interested in what God is interested in, I think that we are going to be fighting a losing battle. Okay, this is 1 Timothy 2. I exhort therefore that first of all supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. Okay, so you can see there that God's will is for all to be saved and all to grow up spiritually, all to come to the knowledge of the truth. Okay, so the Holy Spirit is a big factor in our spiritual growth. The Bible says grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord, the Savior, Jesus Christ. And see, the message of grace, God's compassion, God's love, and all that God has done for us through Christ Jesus is a very powerful message. Very powerful. Now, let me just refer to that. It's kind of difficult for me to get really into that. And, you know, I really would like for you to get those points from the little book. Acts 20, it says this, Acts 20:32. It says, "And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified." Okay, to all them which are sanctified. So the word of grace, and when we think about the word of grace, we are thinking about more or less the grace of God. The grace of God is defined many ways, and we're going to just really break the grace of God down and really begin to go into the different areas of God's grace. But the grace of God is the definition that I use most times is the sum total of all that God has done for us through Christ. All right, y'all repeat what I said. The sum total of all that God has what? Done for us through Christ. All right, but also it also includes the things that God is doing for us now through the Holy Spirit. All right, so the grace of God is all that God has done for us through Christ. Everybody repeat that with me. All that God has done for us through Christ. Sum total of all that God has done for us through, that include the entire realm of his redemptive work. That would be grace. Grace came through Jesus Christ, right?
Yes.
And, you know, we got, that did this so good. Oh, I wish y'all could feed on this. We have a whole area that talks about the grace of God. And what grace does. Because it represents the sum total of all that God has done for us through Christ and all that God is doing for us presently through the Holy Spirit. Now, what's some definitions that we've heard all of our lives concerning grace? Some of the things that you have heard about grace. What is grace to you? Grace is what?
God doing for you what you can't do for yourself.
Okay. Grace is God doing for you what you are unable what to do for yourself. Everybody agree with that? Okay, so the grace of God, you know, it includes salvation. And many times when people think about the grace of God, the only thing that they can think about is what? Salvation. Is that right? God's unmerited favor extends beyond what? Salvation. And it extends to the works of the Holy Spirit. And this scripture in Acts said that the word of his grace, which is able to build you up. So there's saving faith, and there's grace, saving grace, and then there's grace that what? Builds you up. Okay, we're saved by grace, and we are what? Perfected. We are what? We grow by the grace of God. See? So there are many facets of grace, so we just don't want to limit this to just what? Salvation. So grace helps to what? Build us up and give us an inheritance among them which are what? Sanctified. Amen. So how many know that by you being able to live a holy life, live an overcoming life, that's the grace of God. It's not of works. It's nothing that you can do of yourself. Of course, there's a part you play. You have to cooperate, and there's a participation side. But the grace of God is, amen, praise God, is God working in you that which you never would be able to do within, amen, with yourself, amen, by yourself. Amen. So how many appreciate the grace of God? Amen. It was a story that I tell sometimes about this in heaven. It was at the judgment seat, they were trying to decide who made it to heaven was the greatest testimony of a person that was saved by grace. They wanted to get the person that had the most amazing work of grace released into their life. So they got the murderer, all right, they got the serial killer, they got all of these bad, bad folk, the drunkards, the harlots, the prostitutes. They went down the road, the land of all of the people that were saved by grace. And it was some horrible things that people were saved from, and just going down and hearing everybody relate what God had saved them from. And many of them were saved, amen, just before they were called to heaven. They were saved at the spur of the moment. So when they went down the land, the murderer, the criminals, the harlot, the prostitutes, the serial killer, the drug, all of these real horrible people with all of these miraculous stories of how God saved them, and when they were really deeply involved in their various degrading sins. So when the poll was taken, they were voting on who would be the greatest monument of faith. All right, so it seems like it would have been somebody like Brother Scales. It seemed like to me that would have been, Brother Travis would be another one, probably, praise God. I would say, Brother, I would have probably voted for Brother Travis. But we all know somebody that have gone through a lot and that probably was the epitome of degradation. And, but there's some bad folk in this world, but God can save a person from the guttermost to the what? To the uttermost. So when he boiled it down, it wasn't the harlot, it wasn't the drug addict, it wasn't the serial killer, it wasn't the alcoholic and those that lay a real degrading life. They went through tons and tons of these people that had been saved by grace, miraculously. I mean, they have wonderful stories to tell how God reached down and delivered them and rescued them and just really completely turned their lives around. But when everything was settled, they voted on the person that would be the greatest testimony of God's grace. And it settled on a person that was saved at the age of 12. They never got into drugs, they never got into crime, they never got into alcoholism, they never got into the bad stuff of life. And that person stood up and said, at age 12, I was saved from sin. And I never experienced all of the horrible things that all of these people that have related, I never had to go through that. And I never had to be under the dominion of Satan's power. But he was voted as the greatest testimony of faith, because that showed how faith can keep a person, and they don't have to what? I know that people like Brother Scales, they have the best testimonies. Somebody got up and said, I've been saved since I was 12, and I never experienced drugs, and I never went to the clubs, and I never, committed crime, and never was been in jail. Who wants to hear that? Because y'all know I'm telling the truth. When somebody, amen, got these horrible stories, man, they get on the what? On the evangelist circle, and they go all over the place, and people just, man, they just really get excited about people that have those kind of deliverance testimony. I know that God has done a great work in their life, but I believe the greatest testimony is a person that have what? Amen. Use the grace of, applied the grace of God, receive the grace of God, and actually what? Let the grace of God have his what? Full sway, full course, run the full course in their life. And I think the greatest testimony is the person that were kept by the power of God, kept by the Spirit of grace, that never had to what? Amen. Be involved in all of these heinous things. To me, that's the greatest testimony, amen, of what the grace of God is all about. How many believe the grace of God? I mean, God can, the Bible says he's able to keep us from falling. Amen. And he's able to, I mean, he gives us not just saving grace, but he gives us what? Standing grace. The ability to stand. The ability to lead and to live and overcome in life. Okay, I want you to turn to another scripture right quick, because these scriptures about grace really, amen. I know this is not exactly what the lesson is about, but it is, because it's all involved in the what? The grace of God. Okay, Hebrews 15. Hebrews 13. Hebrews 13. Good scripture. It says, let's read it. Read, start with 8th verse. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. Be not carried away about with divers and strange doctrines. For it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace. Amen. It's a good thing that the heart be established, amen, with grace. Not with meats which have not profited them that have been occupied therein. Amen. So grace is able to build you up, is able to give you an inheritance among them which are sanctified. And the scripture that we shared last week, it mentioned about how our hearts can be established in holiness through the grace of God. The grace of God. Let me just show you that too. Our hearts being established in holiness. See, this is the work of grace, not just salvation, but it's the building up of ourselves on our most holy faith. And it's growing and maturing and developing. And this scripture is going to kind of give us some insight as to the things that can really help us to grow and develop. Amen. In faith. Okay. 1 Thessalonians 3, it says this, 12. 1 Thessalonians 3, 12. And the Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another, and toward all men, even as we do toward you. Okay, abounding in love. You know, this is what the scripture repeatedly speaks about, the things that pray, that our prayers for the saints should be centered around, that we might grow and abound and increase in love. That means the fruit of righteousness. These are the things that's really going to establish you. I think anybody will tell you that the thing that keeps you from having a desire to sin or to get off track is actually being involved in something that really satisfies the man on the inside. Amen. That was Brother Scales' secret. He always tells it. Amen. The fruits of righteousness will drive out all of the desire and the motivation to commit things which are contrary to the will of God. It's just like, this is a good illustration, throwing a dog, y'all hear me tell this all the time, a dog sucking this bone, working with this bone. Anybody ever threw a bone out to a dog? Meat on it, amen. He ate the meat, and he just keep working with that bone. All right, now, but when you throw another piece of meat out, he'll what? He'll drop that what? That dry bone, and what? He'll take the meat, right? So anytime you have something that will satisfy you, your spirit, your heart, more than the other thing that maybe you crave to do, and we're speaking about things which are not pleasing to God, then you'll always have a tendency to go with the thing that will gratify or to satisfy or to fulfill the inner man rather than the thing that will just satisfy you for a season. So the secret is doing things, helping others, blessing others. And I do have several areas that we are to be ministering to people, and other areas that we are going to be held accountable at the judgment seat. So we're going to be judged on more than just winning souls. Amen. That's a big part of it, but we're going to be judged on showing kindness and love and reaching out and ministering to people's needs. We're going to be judged on our faithfulness to God. All right? We're going to be judged. You know, I have all of these things that I'm going to be sharing with you. Also, we're going to be judged. This is at the judgment seat. We're going to be judged on how well we kept the body under subjection, how you ran the race, how you handled temptations. All of these things are going to be coming up in judgment. And there will be rewards. There will be certain distinctions and commendations that God will give for those that have done, amen, the works that he has called us to do. Amen. So how many believe that as we increase and bound in love one toward another, okay, one toward another would be towards the what? One toward another would be your love directed to who?
Each other.
Okay, now who is each other? Would be your wife, husband, so. Each other would be who now?
Believers.
Okay, I would think that would be what? Believers. Okay, so there are certain things that we ought to be what? Doing to minister to believers. Okay. What are some of those things? All right, y'all, go.